Blackstone Audio presents A Fool for a Client by Parnell Hall. This book is read by Johnny Heller. For Jim and Franny. Chapter 1.
I have a fool for a client. I didn't doubt it. Richard Rosenberg was one of New York City's top negligence lawyers, with literally thousands of clients. So it was not surprising that one of them should happen to be foolish, particularly since the people who hired an attorney who advertised on TV tended to be less than affluent, less than well-connected, and, inevitably, less than intelligent. Richard didn't have to tell me he had a fool for a client. Having signed up over half of them myself, I could attest to the fact he had several.
"Do you want me to talk to him, Richard?" I said.
Richard frowned.
"Don't try to be funny. I was trying to be funny. Did you really not get it? Don't tell me you're not familiar with that old saw. Let me begin again. I have a fool for an investigator, Richard. A lawyer who represents himself has a fool for a client," Richard said. "Can you possibly not know that?
You're the client?
Sorry, bonus round is over. You get no credit. Yes, I'm the client. It's not bad enough I'm in trouble. I don't even get to joke about it."
"You're in trouble?"
"No, I fell going into my office and I'm suing myself for negligence. I'm my own client and my own defendant. The only issue now is whether I can represent myself against myself. It will certainly expedite things if I'm the attorney on both sides of the suit."
Richard's sarcasm was legendary. His summaries to the jury were often quoted to first-year law students. A little man with a boundless source of nervous energy, Richard wore opposing counsel down through a barrage of whatever leapt like lightning into his diabolically brilliant mind. In such summations, he had been known to talk for 5 minutes straight without ever coming near whatever the hell it was he was supposed to be talking about, until most jurors had lost track of the case they were trying and reasoned the sheer genius of what they had just heard could not possibly be wrong. But even on those occasions, he would eventually get to the punchline. I hoped he would hear.
"I'm at sea, Richard. Who are you trying to sue?"
"Sue?" Richard rolled his eyes. "Stanley, it's not a civil case."
"It's a criminal case?"
"Yes."
"You're the defendant? Didn't I say that?"
"What's the charge?" Richard sighed.
"Murder."
Chapter 2. I sat straight up in my chair. It was not easy to do. The comfortable, overstuffed chair Richard had placed opposite his desk was for the purpose of relaxing clients on the one hand, and making opposing counsel feel small and helpless on the other. It was tough to sit up on the edge. Opponents in the know often pulled up a folding chair or opted to stand.
"Richard, I don't want to spoil your fun, but could you tell me what this is all about?"
Richard groaned. "You can't even do that right. There's no surer way to spoil someone's fun than by saying, I don't want to spoil your fun."
"You're charged with murder."
"I will be."
"Why?"
"I supposedly killed my girlfriend."
"You have a girlfriend?"
"Not anymore." He put up his hand. "Sorry, bad joke. Yes, I had a girlfriend. Maybe that's too strong a word. We'd been going out for a while. Her name's Jeannie Atkins. She was a divorcee, worked as a law clerk for Judge Peters."
"Judge Peters? You were dating Judge Peters' law clerk? Isn't that a conflict of interest?"
Richard shook his head. "See, that point of law you know. Yes, it might have been a conflict of interest, but Judge Peters doesn't do negligence work."
"I knew that. Judge Peters did criminal work, usually high-profile cases of a sensational nature, which is why I knew the name."
"He's not handling this?"
"I don't know who's handling this, but it wouldn't be him. He'd recuse himself. He's doing global banking anyway."
Global banking was a case on the magnitude of Tyco or Enron. Clearly, he wouldn't be free for a while.
"So when was she killed?"
"Last night."
"How did it happen?"
"How did the police think it happened? Or how did it really happen?"
"Do you know how it happened?"
"No."
"What do you know?"
"She was killed last night, most likely between midnight and 1 a.m.
"Were you there?"
"Not when she was killed."
"Why do the police think you were?"
"Because they're morons.
Besides that, I was the last person to see her alive."
"What about the killer?"
"He was the first person to see her dead."
My mouth fell open.
"You can joke about it?"
"I'm in shock, Stanley.
Someone I cared about is dead, inexplicably. Well, maybe not inexplicably. The police think I had something to do with it. I have an acute legal mind. I'm used to rolling with the punches and handling any situation. And I'm utterly lost. I am shaken.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.